Penguin Random House Audio presents We Want to Negotiate, The Secret World of Kidnapping, Hostages, and Ransom by Joel Simon. Read for you by Rob Shapiro. Introduction. During the nearly two decades that I have worked at the Committee to Protect Journalists, my job has been to defend the rights of journalists around the world. Kidnapping and illegal detentions are among the most common threats. I've worked on dozens of such cases, many involving international journalists. In late 2002, Wall Street Journal reporter Daniel Pearl was kidnapped in Karachi, Pakistan by Al-Qaeda. In 2003, Los Angeles Times photographer Scott Dalton, along with a British colleague Ruth Morris, was kidnapped in Colombia by FARC guerrillas. In 2006, Jill Carroll, a reporter working for the Christian Science Monitor, was kidnapped in Iraq. In 2008, Canadian journalist Amanda Lindhout and her Australian colleague Nigel Brennan were kidnapped in Somalia. That same year, New York Times reporter David Rode and his two Afghan colleagues disappeared while reporting in Afghanistan. In some of these cases, publicity was deemed to be helpful, so we cranked out press releases, did media interviews, and developed strategies to put pressure on the kidnappers by building public sympathy. In other cases, the families or the media companies asked for discretion, and we honored such requests, putting out limited information or none at all. Sometimes the journalists were freelancers who did not have a media company to stand up for them. I recall a number of instances in which I had to mediate complex family situations involving divorced parents, exes, and concerned friends, none of whom were clear about who was supposed to make decisions. Responding to a kidnapping puts a tremendous strain on even the best-managed media company. It is all but impossible for a family to bear. This fact hit me directly in the spring of 2014, when I got a call from David Rode. Diane and John Foley, the parents of journalist Jim Foley, were coming to New York. They wanted to see me. Jim Foley had disappeared in Syria in November 2012, and for a time nothing was known about his whereabouts. CPJ had learned that a number of other international journalists had gone missing in Syria around the same time. We knew something bad was up, but we were not sure what. We had been asked not to publish any details about some of the missing journalists, but finally, in order to alert other journalists about the danger, we put out a press release noting the high number. We were certainly aware of Jim's case, as he was a personal friend to many at our organization. I had met him briefly at a photo exhibition in Manhattan. Since Jim's kidnapping in Syria, we had been working closely with Phil Balboni, the publisher of Global Post, where Foley worked. We offered our help and advice, but since Balboni was working behind the scenes with a private security consultant, there wasn't much we could do other than publicly express our concern. Now, after 18 months with little progress, Diane and John had decided to try to raise a ransom to free Jim. They were looking to produce a video and asked for my help. Their idea was to show the video at fundraising events or even screen it for individuals in a position to make a pledge. John and Diane asked if I could find a filmmaker who would take this on. The first several I approached turned me down flat because of the perceived legal risk. Finally, I found a young filmmaker through a contact at Columbia University who agreed to help shoot interviews. We converted the CPJ conference room into a mini studio and invited Jim's friends and colleagues to come by and provide their testimony. We gave this footage to Diane, who eventually found another filmmaker in California to create the final 4-minute video. But the fundraising effort never really got off the ground. In August, Jim was dead. The video was shown at a memorial service held for Jim in October near his family home in Rochester, New Hampshire. I'm sure I was one of the few people in the room who knew its intended purpose. John and Diane, and all of the Foley family, showed tremendous strength and fortitude following Jim's death. They spoke at the CPJ Gala dinner in November 2014, during which we remembered Jim. But colleagues began telling me that in private, Diane was quite critical of CPJ's role. So I asked about her concerns. She told me that CPJ did not do enough for Jim, and that she was disappointed. I conceded that we could have done more, but also explained why we were constrained. At the time, CPJ had a policy of discouraging the payment of ransom, especially by governments, because we believed that paying ransom could lead to additional kidnappings, increasing the risk for all journalists. I also had personal concerns about the legal risks to me and to the organization if we were directly involved in any fundraising effort, since the money raised would go to a terrorist group. Prompted by Diane, we began a review process. We asked a lawyer who had volunteered her time to assist CPJ in researching the rationale for the U.S. no concessions policy, which affirms that the U.S. does not negotiate with terrorists. But this was only the beginning of what has become for me a much more sweeping and comprehensive undertaking. Different countries take different approaches to the kidnapping of their nationals. Some take a hard line, and others are willing to talk. I wanted to understand not only which approach was more effective, but also the moral and political consequences of providing funding to a terrorist organization. And I wanted to look not only at the issue of ransom, but also the structures for analyzing and responding to intelligence and providing ongoing support for hostage families. It's important to put the issue of hostage taking in the proper context, especially because it's so highly emotional. First, the vast majority of kidnappings around the world are criminal in nature. Reliable numbers are hard to come by because many criminal cases go unreported, but just to give some context, more than 1,700 criminal kidnappings were officially recorded in Mexico in 2013, a record year in that country. Authorities concede that the actual number is at least 10 times higher. One Mexican activist estimated the total 2013 kidnapping victims at 27,000. That tally, if accurate, would be vastly more than the total number of terrorism-related kidnappings carried out in the last few decades, although again, that precise number is not known. According to a December 2015 study from the Combating Terrorism Center at West Point, there were 7,048 kidnappings perpetrated by what are called non-state actors between 1970 and 2013. Non-state actors include terrorists, but also militant and tribal groups, and even pirates. The overwhelming majority of these cases were domestic. That means Syrians were kidnapped in Syria, and Colombians were kidnapped in Colombia. The West Point study did find a surge in terrorist kidnapping since 2001, fueled by increases in domestic cases in regions where jihadi organizations were active, mostly the Middle East, Africa, and Asia. From 2001 to 2015, there were 657 kidnapping incidents involving Westerners, an average of about 45 per year. In other words, the kidnapping of Westerners by terror groups is a small subset of the overall problem. But those cases are the focus of this book because they have the ability to influence global policies and provide significant financial support to transnational terror groups whose actions impact millions. Because of my background, many of the cases featured in this book involve journalists. But my intention is to use those cases to illuminate the issues. My conclusions apply to all cases of kidnapping, journalists or not. I focus on kidnapping by non-state actors, terror groups, and transnational criminal groups, but I also briefly discuss hostage-taking by states, the detention of a foreign national on trumped-up charges in order to gain a political concession.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.